Weathering comes in two forms, chemical weathering and physical weathering. We begin our look with chemical weathering. Chemical weathering is or are the processes that alter the internal structure of a rock or mineral by the removal or addition of elements. You know what elements are? Like the periodic chart, hydrogen, oxygen, those things. Okay? There are three types of chemical weathering for our purposes. Oxidation, as you can see, popped up kind of quickly, didn't it? Hydrolysis and carbonation. We're going to go through them right now. It happens that anything that is susceptible to chemical weathering and is exposed to the atmosphere will be exposed to the possibility of all three of these types of chemical weathering. Let's begin with oxidation. Take a look at that photograph there. I was out for a walk, actually, and I saw this. I was like, oh, there we go, oxidation. You've all seen that one before. It's rust, right? Oxidation is the combination of oxygen and a mineral. The metallic minerals are noticeably susceptible to this, but non-metallic minerals can also be affected by oxidation. This is what turns copper green. It's what turns iron into rust, as you can see there. Therefore, anything that is susceptible to it, that's in contact with the atmosphere, because the atmosphere is 21% oxygen, is potentially going to go through this process of oxidation. You probably are aware if you happen to have an old car, or your father or grandfather or grandmother, for that matter, has a very old car, like a car from the 1950s when they were all made out of steel, and you get a scratch on that, in relatively short order, rust is going to begin to form. If you take your finger and you rub it across that rust, the rust comes off on your finger. That's metal, and it has gone through the oxidation process. And of course, by doing that, you now have exposed more of that metallic ore to the atmosphere, which will exacerbate the oxidation process. And eventually, the car ends up looking like that post there, which I believe at one point was probably a clothesline. The second type of chemical weathering for our purposes is called hydrolysis. Hydrolysis is the combination of a mineral and water. Now, this is a particularly important type of chemical weathering when the water is moving, when it's mobile. You can see this along the coastline there, where the water comes in and out and stuff in Northern California. Well, water, when it dissolves minerals, creates a solution. A solution is formed when a substance is dissolved in another substance, in this case, water. Think about it. What is the world's biggest solution? That's right, the global ocean. Very good. Carbonation is the third, for our purposes, of the chemical weathering processes. Carbonation is the combination of minerals and carbon dioxide. This is particularly so when the carbon dioxide is dissolved in water. Rain is a carbonic acid in most cases, because when a raindrop forms, carbon dioxide, which is part of the atmosphere, dissolves in the raindrop, making a carbonic acid. And this type of acid is particularly good at degrading certain types of rocks and minerals, especially limestone and the mineral constituent of limestone, calcite, which is calcium. So if you combine carbon dioxide with certain rocks and minerals, because carbon dioxide is an acid, it will help dissolve them. Because limestone is ubiquitous on the planet, every state in the United States has at least some limestone. And because limestone is particularly susceptible to carbonation, there are specific types of landforms called karst topography or karst landforms that are formed as a result of the chemical weathering of limestone through the carbonation process. Sinkholes are one of these types of landforms. This is over Florida. What happens is acidic solution drips down through the limestone that makes up the state. As it does that, it dissolves the limestone, and then underneath the ground, limestone caves and caverns form. Eventually, the ceilings of those get so thin that they collapse, creating sinkholes on the surface, which are basically collapsed limestone caves or caverns. Inside those caves or caverns, you know the difference between a cave and a cavern? A cave is one hole, a cavern is a series of interconnected holes. Inside, if you envision the ceiling of the cave and a drop of water comes down through the limestone and reaches the ceiling and then drops down to the floor of the cave, it may very well leave behind a small amount of residue on the ceiling. Over very long periods of time, that residue builds up and it makes stalactites. Stalactites are the icicle-like formations that hang down from the ceiling of a limestone cave. You can see them in this photograph. And when that water drops and hits the ground, provided it doesn't pool up into a stream or a pool of water or a little lake underneath the ground, provided it hits and then is able to run away, it may very well leave behind some residue, creating stalagmites. Stalagmites are the inverted icicle-like formations that grow upwards from the floor of a limestone cave. Both of these are types of karst topography. Now, if you take a look at this photograph, imagine that the tops of those hills are where the landscape used to be, but these are remnant landforms. And what happened is everything there is all limestone, and over a very long period of time, all of the limestone dissolved. The only thing left are these seemingly uplifted landforms, but are not uplifted landforms. What they are in reality is remnant landforms. We call these things haystack hills. They're also known as hums or karst towers. You can see in this photograph that they're actually very large. So haystack hills or hums or karst towers are just simply steep-sided, cave-riddled, remnant karst landforms. They're the result of differential weathering, which means that different rocks degrade at different rates. Even the same rock will degrade at different rates depending on its exposure.